So last week, Standard & Poor's announced that Tesla would be added to the S&P 500. This is a game changer. This is like, this is the holy grail of stock price boosting, momentum-driven growth. In this video, I'm going to talk about how this addition to the S&P 500 will drive Tesla's stock through the moon. There's roughly $11 trillion that mimic the S&P 500. What I mean by that is there are other index funds out there that are S&P 500 lookalikes, and they represent about $11 trillion of the money that is invested throughout the world. Now, imagine you make a change to the S&P 500, which means a stock has to come out and Tesla goes in. Now, they're the seventh biggest company in the world right now. And based on how their allocation will be in the S&P 500 is based on market capitalization. What is market capitalization? It's really simple. Number of shares outstanding times the stock price. So find out what the stock price is, find out what the number of shares are, multiply it together, and that's their market capitalization. Well, the S&P 500 weights their companies within the S&P 500 based on market capitalization weighting. So Tesla, as of today, will most likely be the seventh biggest allocation within the S&P 500. And as their stock price increases, and maybe some of those other companies' prices decrease, they'll move up the scale and become a bigger and bigger and bigger part of the S&P 500. So this really means that on December 21st, when Tesla is added to the S&P 500, that billions upon billions of dollars will be bought into Tesla and will most likely drive their stock price higher. How do you get into the S&P 500? Well, you gotta be a profitable company. Now in September, Tesla was profitable, I believe, for over a year. And at that point, they should have been added to the S&P 500, but they were rejected. Now today, as of last week, S&P 500 will allow Tesla to be part of the index and will be a big part of the S&P 500 index. Now, there are other indexes out there like the MSCI, many other global world indexes where Tesla already is put in place. But this means that when the S&P 500 puts them in on December 21st in $11 trillion of index funds that mimic the S&P 500 have to go out and buy Tesla. Well, supply and demand, right? Supply and demand. Here's the thing about being in the S&P 500. Once you're in, fundamentals and profitability go out the door. I mean, you can be profitable, get into the S&P 500, and all of a sudden become unprofitable and stay in the S&P 500. So there are companies in the S&P 500 who are financially not sound. Fundamentally, they don't, as Standard & Poor's doesn't look at the fundamentals of the company. So this is a bit of a skew on how you perceive the S&P 500. Not all of those companies are good companies. Not all of those companies are profitable companies. And not all of those companies really have any, well, weighting that could move their stock price higher because of their market capitalization weighting. See, if you're number 499 of that stock, your allocation in the S&P 500, well, it's about that big. Well, where the movement in the S&P 500 is really coming from is really the top 10 positions. And now that Tesla is going to be a part of that, all that money that's going into 401k plans, and with the millennial and X and Y generations dumping money into growth-oriented companies, chances are Tesla will be a part of that benefiting factor in the movement higher of the S&P 500 in a big way. Now the question is, would you pay 100 times the earnings projections for 2021 of a company, 100 times? And the way you can look at that is, Are you willing to pay for a company's stock price today that is projected to be that in 100 years? Meaning, if you have a PE ratio of 100, price to earnings ratio of 100, you're saying, I'm willing to pay what this stock price will be in 100 years today for that price. Well, and that's where the fundamentals really go out the window with a lot of these tech companies. Well, really any company at this point. And it is that whole fundamental element that is being really thrown out the window. Because is Tesla really worth 100 times what it is? Is it worth paying Tesla prices that are projected to be what they are in 100 years today? Well, if you're part of the S&P 500, I would say, yeah, probably. So I got to thinking, what is the last big mega company out there that went into the S&P 500 that we all use today? And especially since COVID hit, we shop using this company, and that's Amazon. What was their stock price when they got introduced to the S&P 500? Well, I went and did some digging. And in November 5th of 2005, so November 5th of 2005, Amazon was trading at, I believe, $44.50 a share on that day, at closing on that day, $44.50. Fast forward to today, and that is a 6,820% increase in the stock price. Do you wish you had bought $10,000 of Amazon in November 5th of 2005? Let's look at what that means to Tesla. Now, I'm a big believer that this whole renewable energy, electric cars, the whole solar world is going to create the first trillionaire. Okay, and what I mean by that is, if Amazon created the first big time billionaire in Jeff Bezos, and renewable energy is the forefront of this world of where we're gonna be in 15 years, chances are they're gonna be trillionaires. And so I look at a company like Tesla and I go, is it worth buying it today at the 500 and some odd dollars that it's trading at as of today? Is it worth buying a chunk of it and holding it for 15 years? And for me, in 15 years, I will be 66 years old, and that would really come in. And if it grows at the rate of Amazon's growth, and in my belief of the next trillionaire, richest man or woman in the world will have something to do with renewable energy. Well, I gotta believe maybe Elon is that guy. So would it be worth buying a chunk of Tesla and just not looking at it for 15 years? And the way I see it is, it's gonna get there. It's gonna see the price growth that Amazon's seen since 2005. It will see the same growth rate. So if it's 6,820% increase since its introduction into the S&P 500, if Tesla experiences the same level of growth, holy cow, that $10,000, that's worth a lot of money. And since we're in this retirement crisis zone right now, where people don't have enough money to retire, even though they're retired, a purchase like that, for me, well, it makes a lot of sense. And since I believe that renewable energies and alternative energies are going to be the future, I mean, something I'm thinking about today is, who finds the way to create furnaces that can melt metal with electricity? The guy who figures that out eliminates oil, eliminates China's standpoint or strength when it comes to manufacturing. Once you figure that out, anybody who has consistent sunlight and heat from the earth can now take over manufacturing with some version of an electric furnace, because you got to melt metal. And right now we use carbon-based materials to generate electricity. If we can use the sun, if we can use the flow of water or wind, and it can create the amount of heat to melt metal, the Middle East most likely will be out of the oil business and in the manufacturing business, because they got the sun, they got the heat, and if they can create a way to do it, oil will be gone, electricity will come in, China will be out the door when it comes to manufacturing, and the Middle East will be the hub of global manufacturing. In closing, the introduction of Tesla into the S&P 500 is a game changer. And what I believe we should be looking at is, one, they're the starting point. Two, who are making the parts that propel electric vehicles and in alternative energy? And those companies, because GM and Ford and Jaguar and BMW and really everybody is getting into the electric vehicle business, we need to find the companies who are manufacturing the devices that create the energy that propel the growth of alternative energy.